Warning. Tungsten salts are toxic in large doses as tungsten is a heavy metal. Thorium is radioactive and dust particles can become lodged in the lungs. Wear gloves when handling them and work in a fume hood. Greetings, fellow nerds. I really like my Radiocode 103 and I've been having a lot of fun examining and collecting various radioactive substances. And to get good data on the various gamma spectrums I obtain, I need to constantly recalibrate it. Especially since the response isn't perfectly linear across its energy range as shown in my previous video on the Radiocode. If I calibrate on the high end, the higher energy peaks are accurate, but the lower ones are off and vice versa. It's not a problem, but is annoying to keep doing. To calibrate it, my favorite gamma source is the thoriated tungsten rods. They have several gamma peaks and this makes it very useful for calibration across the energy range as I can use it for both low energy and high energy ranges. But what I don't like about them is that the signal is not that strong. So I need to collect a spectrum over several hours, even days, to get a nice clean spectrum. I'd like a strongly radioactive source for calibration purposes. Of course not too strong, I'm not going to collect Chernobyl corium for obvious reasons, but I would like something stronger than this. These thoriated tungsten rods are good and easy to get, but they only have about 2% thorium in them. Additionally, because they're alloyed with tungsten, a very dense heavy metal, some of the radiation is attenuated by hitting the tungsten before it can escape to the surface. So to get a stronger signal, I'm going to concentrate all the thorium in these tungsten rods into a vial and remove most of the tungsten. Now usually to do something like that, we chemists would dissolve the metals in acid. Unfortunately, tungsten is very resistant to most acids. I left it in there for 2 hours and there was no visible change. I also tried aqua regia, but that didn't work either. I've read that it can dissolve in chlorine and bromine at high temperatures, or in nitric acid if there are fluoride ions as a catalyst. Interestingly enough, tungsten does dissolve in hydrogen peroxide somewhat, and I'll demonstrate that later. But as a bulk dissolution process, it is somewhat difficult to control and can even go into thermal runaway, making it less desirable for amateur purposes. So we're going to use a simpler and safer approach by applying our favorite and most powerful oxidant known to science, electricity. To do that, we first make our electrolyte of 40 grams of sodium hydroxide dissolved in 200 milliliters of water. When we apply electricity to this solution, it will dissolve tungsten and thorium, but the thorium will precipitate out. I selected this quantity because I weighed my tungsten rods to be about 60 grams. So this amount of sodium hydroxide should completely dissolve it. You'll need to adjust your quantities if you're using more or less. Now set up our electrolytic cell with a constant current power supply. And we use thoriated tungsten rods for both our anode and cathodes. Only the anodes will dissolve, so you can use a copper or carbon cathode if you want. I'm using tungsten rods for convenience. Now apply a constant current of about 1 to 2 amps and set a maximum voltage of about 6 volts. And there it goes. What's happening is the tungsten is being oxidized at the anode to tungstate ions. Because the electrolyte is sodium hydroxide, they react with the tungstate to produce sodium tungstate, which is soluble. At the cathode, we're just electrolyzing water into hydrogen and more hydroxide. Meanwhile, the thorium dioxide added to the rods during manufacture just falls out. And that's how we extract our thorium from the thoriated tungsten rods. A rather simple process if you know the trick of using electrolysis. Now if you use straight rods like this, then you can run into the situation where the rods dissolve unevenly and may snap them at the middle before the rods completely dissolve. You also run into the issue that because the clip that holds the rod is out of solution, some of the tungsten rod is wasted being conductor to the clip. There are various tricks to get around both issues, but my favorite one is to use this titanium tea infuser. This serves as an anode basket and holds the dissolving anode while also providing a conductive connection. And since it's made of titanium, the basket itself will not dissolve. So it's a great way of efficiently using up the whole tungsten rod. Just attach the anode clip to it and put the tungsten rods in. Unfortunately, it creates another problem as the tungsten dissolves and releases thorium dioxide, The thorium dioxide is non-conductive and insulates the tungsten, blocking further current flow. I solved that by having a stir bar and strongly stirring the beaker. The vibrations dislodge the tungsten and the thorium dioxide and allows the tungsten to make contact with the beaker again. So I left that going for a couple of days. It's moving around because the stir bar was strong enough to knock the beaker around, but it did work. And here we are a couple of days later. Let me wash that down. That is a solution of sodium tungstate with precipitate thorium dioxide. Boil the solution for a few minutes to dissolve and break up any sodium tungstate or carbonates. After cooling, I try to filter the thorium dioxide, but the particles are so fine they pass through. Fortunately, they are pretty heavy and I could simply decant off the supernatant. Then I washed it with water a few times and repeated the decantation process. If you're having a lot of trouble with the particles not settling after a few hours, you can help the process a little by adding a flocculating agent. This is a separate run I was experimenting on, and I added 100 milligrams of aluminum sulfate dissolved in a few milliliters of water. The flocculating agent will help settle the particles, but it does contaminate your thorium dioxide with aluminum oxide later. It'll have negligible effect on radiation output, but if you're making thorium dioxide for element collection, keep this in mind. Alternatively, you may be able to use organic flocculating agents sold as clarifiers for swimming pools. These have the advantage of burning away in the drying step. Anyway, I transferred the thorium dioxide wet into a vial and dried the vial in oven. And that is our concentrated vial of thorium dioxide. This particular run is not very pure and has bits of tungsten dust that got dislodged during electrolysis. But it's still much more concentrated than the rods, and we can see considerably more activity from the vial than from the rods alone. If you really want to remove all tungsten contamination, then after decanting the electrolyte, but before you wash it, add in some hydrogen peroxide. I'm using 50 milliliters of 5% hydrogen peroxide. Let it react for a few days at room temperature and it will slowly dissolve the tungsten particles. What's happening is the hydrogen peroxide and remaining sodium hydroxide react with the tungsten to make sodium tungstate. It's a great cleanup step, although it is slow. You can make it go faster by using higher concentration hydrogen peroxide of 30% or so, or gently heating the solution. But be careful as a reaction can easily go into thermal runaway. So you may need to dunk it in cooling. For this reason, I prefer using the electrolytic method for bulk dissolution of tungsten and use the hydrogen peroxide for cleanup. Electricity is more controlled and much cheaper than peroxide. Anyway, after peroxide treatment, you can wash and decant as usual. So back to my first vial. I was able to get a nice clean spectrum for my radiocode in several hours rather than a few days. Now an interesting point about thorium gamma spectra is these peaks are not directly from thorium, but actually from the daughter products, most of which is radium. Fortunately, this alkaline electrolytic processing method retains the radium, so we still get all these good peaks. But keep this in mind if you try modifications or alternative processing techniques. If you lose the radium, the spectrum will change a little bit. I'm thinking I might try and separate the trace amount of radium from the thorium dioxide, but let me know in the comments if there's interest. It's only a trace amount. Before I go, a special note about the sodium tungstate supernatant solutions after decantation. I'm gonna save mine because I might use the sodium tungstate in future videos to make tungsten trioxide and other chemicals, but if you want to dispose of yours, don't dump it down the sink. Tungsten is a somewhat toxic heavy metal, and depending on your country, the solution may be categorized as low-level radioactive waste. If you need to dispose of it, mix it with excess calcium chloride or calcium nitrate solutions to precipitate the tungsten ions as insoluble calcium tungstate. Calcium tungstate is a relatively insoluble mineral which is much safer to handle and dispose of. But anyway, that is how we get thorium dioxide from commercially available thoriated tungsten rods. Granted, it's probably easier to obtain other gamma sources for calibration, but not nearly as fun. I also did this just to expand my element collection. Thanks for watching. And special thanks to Radiocode for sponsoring this video. If you want your own Radiocode gamma spectrometer, use my affiliate link in the video description. Special thank you to all of my supporters on Patreon for making these science videos possible with their donations and their direction. If you're not currently a patron but would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, then check out my Patreon page here or in the video description. I really appreciate any and all support.